27 Advent Children! Yes, it's finally time for me to talk about this movie. And it's just as well, too, because this last episode in this month of Final February also happens to be my 1 year anniversary. Can you believe it? I can't believe it's already been 1 year since I decided that my opinion was valuable enough to spew to the entire world. Yeah, I've had some good times on this show. Good times. A lot of bad times, too, as my night terrors will never let me forget. But you guys gotta know that it's been totally worth it bringing you weekly fun times while dealing with physical and mental torture. So, to celebrate all this specialness coinciding all at once, we're gonna talk about a movie that I have been wanting to talk about since day one of this show. Final Fantasy VII Advent Children. Like, I'm so excited! I'm so excited I can't even stand it! I gotta- Bitches! But now we got a bucket load of history coming your way, so open wide! Final Fantasy VII Advent Children is a direct-to-DVD movie that was developed by Square Enix, directed by Tetsuya Nomura, and released in Japan in 2005 and North America in 2006 following several pushbacks on the release date. The movie itself is a direct sequel to the PlayStation 1 game Final Fantasy VII and is part of the compilation of Final Fantasy VII's series of media. But that's enough words coming out of this mouth, because it's time to ring in the new year of reviews and put an end to this month-long event with a look at Final Fantasy VII Advent Children. Now, for starters, believe me when I say that the plot of this movie is about as dense as a concrete wall. While I personally like these types of solid plots, I will admit that this one is a little... too thick. Anyway, Advent Children's plot takes place 2 years after the end of Final Fantasy VII, and the world is trying to rebuild following Meteor Fall and Sephiroth's defeat at the hand of Cloud Strife. While Cloud, along with Tifa, Cloud's childhood friend, Marlene, their semi-adopted daughter, and Denzel, their legitimately adopted orphan boy, try to maintain some semblance of a normal life, Cloud gets inadvertently swept up in another conflict when three remnants of Sephiroth named Kadaj, Yazoo, and Laws appear and begin searching for the severed head of Genova, their supposed mother, which will allow them to reform as Sephiroth Reborn. Cloud, with all his friends and party members from the game, band together to stop Kadaj's gang from taking hold of Genova's head and bringing about Sephiroth's return. I bet the majority of you who've never played Final Fantasy VII are probably sitting there like this. And it's really no damn surprise. This plot is not at all kind to newcomers. It tries to give some info on the events that lead to the movie's plot, but it's still as inaccessible as God's private bathroom to those who haven't spent hundreds of hours studying everything about FF7. Good thing I'm here then, because I have spent hundreds of hours studying everything about Final Fantasy VII. And even with my extensive knowledge of everything about it, it's still very hard to grasp. But let's creep over to the characters, and let's start with the big motherfucker of RPG protagonists, Cloud Strife. This spiky-haired bishonen gets involuntarily sucked into the conflict with Kadaj and the others by trying to overcompensate for his past failures. Cloud spends the majority of the movie mired in a cesspool of self-loathing and despondency until he finally decides that saving the people you care about is more important than sulking. Now, I know a lot of people complain about Cloud's whiny, douchebag, emo personality, but you gotta see it from the character's point of view. When you take everything into consideration, Cloud has been through a ton of shit. Cloud has been stripped of his dream, nearly killed, modified into a Sephiroth clone, poisoned by Mako, got his best friend murdered, had his psyche shattered, got thousands of innocent people crushed to death, allowed one of his love interests to die, doomed the planet to destruction due to possession by Sephiroth, poisoned by Mako again, forced to go to the very center of the planet to do battle with the most powerful soldier in history, then he gets infected with the deadly geostigma infection while trying to cure Denzel's geostigma as well. I mean, come on, guys, that would fuck anyone up. While I won't defend everything Cloud says or does in the movie, I will say that I still like him. Quite a lot, actually. Even though he's got this self-pitying attitude for the majority of the runtime, I find his gradual redemption to be endearing, like watching a flower bloom after a long, cold night. Say what you will about Cloud, but he certainly has a lot of fortitude to survive everything that's come his way. There's also Tifa Lockhart, Cloud's supportive childhood friend who lives with him in her bar called Seventh Heaven, Marlene, Barrett Wallace's adopted daughter who currently stays with Tifa and Cloud and who really needs to shut up, Denzel, a young boy who lost everything when Sector 7 of Midgar was destroyed before the events of the movie, who suffers from geostigma and is generally just a tool for Cloud's redemption, as well as all the party members from the original game. Don't got a lot to say about any of them, because all their personalities take a backseat to Cloud's journey. And I guess that's okay. We got to explore most of their personalities in the game, so meh, I suppose. If you're curious, go play the damn game. It's worth it! As for the villains, Kadaj, Yazoo, and Laws, I don't have a whole lot to say about them either. Laws is silly, Yazoo is pointless, and Kadaj is just a creepy mama's boy. I know it sounds like I'm being lazy with the character descriptions, but trust me, if I had more to say, I would say it. But I don't. So, yeah. In summary, characters are really not this movie's strong point. Now, let me talk about the good things, and forgive me if I sound a wee bit biased here. I always try my best to see both sides of everything, but this movie is so close to my heart and has influenced so much of my current being that I think it'll be impossible to talk about it without having a bit of partiality sneak in. With that in mind, though, let me just say what's painfully obvious. The animation quality is superb. While it's not quite up there with The Spirits Within, it was clear that that movie's animation quality was purely to show off. Whereas Advent Children's high quality is there to evolve the style from the super deformed designs of the past, as well as convey more emotions, even if the characters' mouths barely open all the way most of the time. And holy Dunkin' Dog shit, the action sequences, man. The action sequences in this movie are just minutes upon minutes of pure condensed badassery. Yeah, they have a lot of physics-defying moments, sure, but each fight and battle just keeps getting bigger and better, becoming more and more intense and insane as it goes on until your heart stops from being flooded with adrenaline! And, oh baby, let me tell you, that musical score makes me sploosh like a horny schoolgirl every time I hear it. Not just the adaptations of songs from the original game recomposed by the game's original composer Nobuo Uematsu, but even the original music is just, well, there's no other word for it. It's incredible, right down to the littlest note. But the ultimate thing I will praise about this movie is that it doesn't exist for any other reason than to be a love letter to fans. There's a nastier word for this, and it's called fan service, but nah. Fan service is lazy, and this movie is anything but lazy. It's a direct sequel with no visible intent to cash in on popularity. It's made purely for the people who love the original game as much as I do, or even more. Sure, there are some fundamental flaws in creating something for this purpose, but I say shut your face hole to that. It's a gift to those who love the world that was created for them, and I have nothing but respect for that. Flaws and all. And speaking of flaws, let's hope I have some saliva left to talk about the bad things. And yes, there are bad things. As I already said, the plot is about as dense as a concrete wall, but that doesn't even do it justice. Believe me when I say that I've watched this movie at least 100 times for realsies, and there are still things about it I don't understand, but it's not for lack of trying. Oh, I've done my homework and looked up every scrap of info I could, but there are some things that have not, do not, and will not make sense, no matter how hard I try. Also, there are quite a few of these awkward scenes that just linger for a long time and don't really progress anything plot-wise. I can't see the point of them for the most part. Oh, and that reminds me, you want something awkward, try listening to the comedic relief. While none of the comedy is flat-out terrible, most of it can only garner a discomfited half-chuckle from me, as it's just so odd and out of place that you can't help but laugh uncomfortably. Luckily, though, these moments don't last too long. Another little thing is, at least in the English version, everyone has a habit of speaking exclusively in trailer talk! And what I mean by that is, every line of dialogue the characters spew could be chopped out and placed in a trailer because, ooh, everything they say is just so deep and important. Despite these flaws, though, I still stand by this movie, and I would defend it to the death. Not because of its overall quality, but because of how special it is to me on a personal level. I mean, this is the movie that got me through those terrible days as a teenager when the world just seemed so much more cruel and cold than usual. It's a movie that made me feel happy. It made me feel strong. It made me feel like I could do anything. It's the movie that inspired me to take an analytical eye towards movies, and eventually to cartoons in general. It's the reason I wear gloves every day. It's the reason I have goggles on my hat. It's shaped so much of who I am, and I guess, if nothing else, I thank it for that. But, does that mean I recommend Advent Children? Well, no, actually, it doesn't. What I do recommend is, if you have the version of Advent Children that's on DVD, I recommend that you swiftly burn it and get yourself this instead. This is Advent Children Complete, a Blu-ray-only director's cut of the movie that is superior to the original version in every single way, with the exception of Marlene's atrocious new voice actress. For example, not only is there all new updated animation with 25 minutes worth of new scenes that help better explain the story and character motivations, but it also heavily revamps the final battle between Cloud and Sephiroth. And when I say revamp, I mean it turns this into this. Just for the final battle alone, I recommend this to the ends of the earth. Final Fantasy VII Advent Children will never be pried loose from that very special place it holds in my heart, but I still say that it can be off-putting for many people. With a story as easy to digest as a freshly shat brick, somewhat boring characters, and some more than awkward scenes, it can definitely turn some people away. But that's okay too. It just means this movie wasn't meant for you anyway. This movie is, in the purest sense of the word, a gift to the faithful, the loyal, and the lovers of Final Fantasy VII. And in spite of its problems, it is certainly a very important part of this story's legacy, and my own.
I give Final Fantasy VII Advent Children.
Three and a half eyes out of five.
So, Advent Children, is it watchable? No, it really isn't. Like, I don't care what you gotta do, just find a way to get Advent Children Complete. Trust me, you'll never want to watch the original version again. It is superior in every single way. That is the one that is truly watchable. Is it enjoyable? Well, for this movie in particular, that is completely 100% subjective, so I won't say anything in general. But, for me, personally, I enjoyed it the first time, and I enjoyed it just as much the 100th time. Is it memorable? Well, this movie, and the story of Final Fantasy VII itself, has certainly stood the test of time. While it may not be widely known outside the concerned circles, those who are concerned definitely hold it close to their hearts, and it won't be forgotten anytime soon. Speaking of that, thank you all for joining me for this last episode in Final February and for my 1 year anniversary! I can't even tell you how much you guys rock. Just as I hold this movie in a special place in my heart, so too do I hold every single one of you who subscribed and watched me in my heart. Very, very special place, you gotta trust me. So, that's it for today, and I feel like celebrating some more, so I think I'm gonna find a place that's got more partying going on. You know, I hear there's a place in Oregon right now that's having a pretty crazy party, so I think I'm gonna go there. See you all next time. Toodles, everybody. That was distributed by... Fuck. Shit. Need to get my facts right. After facing several pushback on the date. Oh, I'll get this right eventually. Fend it to the death. Jesus. I'm sorry, Cloud. And instead... Oh, where'd it go? Where did it... Where the... Oh, it's on my lap. When the world just seemed much more cold and cruel than- Damn it, Hanami, you ruined the take!
Want to stay up to date with the latest Eye of Sol news? You can follow me on Twitter as well as on Facebook at twitter.com/eyeofsol299 and facebook.com/eyeofsol. I update them every day, so if you want to check out news on the show as well as updates, just follow the links here.
Hey everybody, thank you so much for watching my final review in Final February and my 1 year anniversary! Can you seriously believe it's already been 1 year? I honestly can't believe it, it's crazy. If you could drop a like and a share with this video, as well as a subscription to my channel, I would really appreciate that, because it makes me smile. And you want to see me smile, don't you? If you want to see the previous Final February episodes, you can see the annotations playing in the video right now. Or if you want to check out my various social media sites, you can see my links to my Twitch channel, Twitter page, and my Facebook fan page there on the screen for you, as well as in the description. Have an idea for an animated series or movie you want me to comment on? You can leave me a message in the YouTube comments on any one of my social media sites, or just let me know in any way you can think of to let me know what you want to see, and I will add it to my list. Okay? Thanks again for watching, everybody, and I will see you next week for another review.